Hello again. This is Chris from Colorado. I'm going to give you an unbelievable story that just happened a month ago. It ties in with the first story that I gave you recently about me and my uncle shooting at several Bigfoot just to get away while we were out hunting when I was 16 years old. This ties into that story, but no one's going to believe this one, but it is true. On my grandpa's grave, it's true. So I'm 38 years old now, and I live in a small town called Aguilar, Colorado. My house is on the southwest end of town. Aguilar has a population of 200. It really is the tiniest town ever. There's my house and an empty lot on one road, and just on the other side of that road is a big row of trees. On the other side is a hayfield that leads straight up into the mountains. Every spring and summer, that's where the bears come down from. Last winter, there was a mama bear with three cubs that came down. Me and my granddaughter, we fed them. But that's another story. So the day is the 20th of February, 2023. I go outside and I throw some trash out. It's early in the morning. I come back in and I make breakfast for everyone. Then I get dressed and I go outside. I try picking up the yard and then I try tilling up the front of my yard to make a garden ready for the summer. I go back to the back part of my shed and get my tools. Then I start taking all the weeds and the stuff to the back. And I noticed right by the back door of the house, there's something green and bushy. It looked like a wreath from Christmas that you would put on a door. I thought, what is that? I knew it wasn't there an hour ago when I came out, so I went over, and you won't believe it, but right in the middle of that pile of branches was my backpack, my old one, the one that I had dropped when I was hunting, when I was 16 years old, out with my uncle. This is that backpack, the one the Bigfoot were looking through, and eating my grandmother's breakfast burritos. I got chills all up and down my body. It really freaked me out. What's also kind of crazy is my neighbor's two big Great Danes. Well, they never made a sound, and they're very close. So how did it get there, when I know it wasn't there just an hour ago? I didn't know. I stood there with my back towards the tree line, which was about 50 yards from my house. Sitting even with that tree line is an old house that's been there as long as I've been alive. The road there is a big road with trees up and down it. And next to the road, which runs east to west, just past those trees is the hayfield. Then it's straight on up into the mountains. Well, I just stood there with my back towards the trees for a minute. Then I heard him knock. I didn't move or anything. I stood still and kept looking down at my bag. But I heard it. I turned around, slowly. I kept looking down as I walked to the middle of the yard, heading towards the front yard. I just kept looking at my bag as I walked. I heard another knock. So I stopped and I faced the trees. Slowly I looked up, and right there, 50 yards away from me, there he was standing by a tree. Only his hand was showing a little bit on the tree, and his left eye was watching me. I could only see a little bit of the top of his head. Then he popped back behind the tree. I walked up to the fence line. There was an old tree on that fence line that I had cut down, and there was an old apple tree, too. I took a hammer from one of my tools, and I hit the tree. Boom, boom, boom. The Bigfoot peeped out again at me. So I looked at my backpack, and I gave him a thumbs up. He just went back behind the tree quickly. Then he peeped out again, and he looked at me. Now I can see both eyes and his whole face. I tried lifting up one finger, like I was saying, 1 minute, just 1 minute, hang on. And I grabbed the backpack. I went inside the house and looked through everything. I saw that in the backpack there was one of my bullets that I shot that day many years ago. It must have been stuck in a tree. You could see all the wood fragments that had been pried out with it. There was also my pocket knife down in there. It was one of the small kinds, one of the old-timer pocket knives that my grandpa had kept in his pocket and gave to me. It wasn't even an inch big, and it was pretty beat up. It looked like maybe they'd been interested in it, or they were trying to do something with it. I took the knife out. I set it on the table to look at later. I started filling the backpack up with food for the ones that I wanted to be friends with. I grabbed apples, bananas, some Capri Suns, which would get me in trouble later, a bag of some Applejack cereal, and some other foods. I also put in a jar of moonshine that I make. I thought it would be interesting to see if they could open it and what they would do with it. I go outside and I couldn't tell if the Bigfoot was still out there or not. I knocked on the tree again a few times. I checked the zipper on the bag and was getting ready to leave it for them when I hear the loudest boom I've ever heard. I look up and there he is again. He steps out completely from behind a tree. I thought he was big when I was 16 years old, but this guy is an animal. He's huge. I try to look at the tree that's next to him, so I can maybe gauge his height when he's gone. His head reaches the second branch on that tree. I make sure to remember that. I held the backpack in my right hand, and I gave him a thumbs up with my left hand. He tilted his head back and forth like a confused dog would. I don't think he knew what a thumbs up meant. This Bigfoot that I was looking at had brown and white hair, and he had a lot of the white hair, so I think he was the grandpa of the group I met before. He was their leader, and he was massive. I mean a really massive creature. You could see his muscle tone, his pecs, his biceps, and his legs. They were like huge tree trunks. His arms hung down well past his knees. I put my thumb down, and I rubbed my goatee with my left hand while still holding the backpack in my right. To my surprise, he does the exact same thing. He's mimicking my actions with his hands. I'm not even kidding you. Even retelling this story gives me chills, and it makes me excited all over again, like he's out there right now as I'm telling you this story, and it's 3:40 a.m. here in Colorado. Anyway, at that time, he's mimicking me, so I put my hand down. I point at the backpack, then I point to him. He looks at me while I'm doing that, then he steps back. I walk to the back of the yard, and I go out behind my fence and into the lot with the intention of leaving the backpack there. He's watching every move I make. So it goes from 55 yards to about 30 yards of distance between me and him. In the middle of that is a cement foundation, like a house would be on. I stopped there when I heard him make a grunting sound. It was as if he was telling me to stop. I was getting too close to him. I looked at him, and I held up my left hand, and then I held up the backpack with my right hand. I was showing my hands like I was getting arrested. I pointed at the backpack, then I pointed to him, then back to the backpack, and then back to him again. All the while, he kept tilting his head from left to right, like a confused dog again. So I set the backpack down. I pointed between the backpack and him a few more times, hoping he got my meaning. Then I began stepping backwards, facing him the whole time, until I reached the fence. Instead of walking around that fence, I jumped the fence. It was just a normal chain-link fence, so I was able to jump right over it. I walked towards my patio, and I see my wife and my 2-year-old granddaughter inside the house, and I can see my 2 dogs. I have a red-nosed pit bull and a little chihuahua. Even before this, I would let the dogs out to use the bathroom in the middle of the night sometimes, and they would not go out in the yard. They would go down to the end of the deck where the steps are, but they would go no further. I have a big floodlight out there. I would turn it on all the time, but I never saw anything, and still they would never go out in the yard. Now I think he was out there. I don't know how he found my house and found me after all these years. I have no idea to this day. It's mind-boggling. I have no idea how he found me after all these years. But anyway, I get to the sliding door and I open it. I tell my wife to grab the baby and I tell her, don't freak out. Just grab the baby, come outside, and make sure you leave the dogs inside. Then I told her to look ahead straight into the trees across the road. And I told her to be calm. Do not freak out. Do not scream. Just come on out like it's any other day. My wife asks me, what the F are you talking about? So I told her again, just come on out. I opened the door for her and the baby while keeping the dogs inside. I said to her, look ahead in the tree line. She said, what are you talking about? I said, look, and don't freak out. My wife looks up, and there he is, standing there still. She said, what is that? Now, she doesn't have her glasses on, so I step inside to get her glasses off the table. I came back out and handed them to her. Then I took the baby from her. We go to the end of the deck, to the railing, to watch and to look. She has her glasses on now, and she said, oh my God, what is that? Is that what I think it is? I said, remember I told you the story of me and my uncle hunting all those years ago? She said, yeah. I said, well, that's him. That's one of the Bigfoot we saw that day. He found out where I live, and he brought my backpack back. It's right there in the lot on the cement foundation. She looked and then she said, are you kidding me? I said, no, he brought my bag back. There was a bullet in there that I had shot that stuck a tree, and there was my knife. Then I said, I don't know how he found out where I lived, but he did. I loaded that backpack with food. She asked what I had given him in that backpack, so I told her. And that's how I got in trouble for giving away the grandbaby's Capri Suns and fruit snacks. I could see my wife was about to freak out over all of this. I reminded her again to not freak out. Then she said, he could have killed you when you took that backpack over there. I said, no, he knows I'm trying to befriend him. Then I said, come on, we should go inside. Let's close the door and just wait and see if he comes for the bag. We kept watch all day, but there was a lot of traffic going in and out over there on that road, and after a while, I didn't see him anymore. This is around 10 a.m. I would say by noon, he was gone. We kept watching the bag all day to see if it was still out there. It was still there at 7 p.m., and it was still there at 9:30 p.m., and it was still there at 11:30 p.m. when I went to let the dogs out. Seeing that the backpack was still there, I said to myself, well, I guess he ain't coming for it. I guess he didn't understand that the bag was for him. Me and my wife were lying in bed talking about it, and it was about 12:30 or 1 o'clock in the morning. I got up and tried to let the dogs out again, but they would not go out in the yard. They stuck their heads outside and would not even go out onto the end of the deck. So I gave up and I closed the door. I told my wife to put the dogs in the bathroom. She said, what do I look like to you? I looked over at her with eyes wide and said calmly, get the dogs and put them in the bathroom. Please be calm and don't be loud. Now, all night I hadn't seen anything, so I just closed the door. I went over to the gun case and I grabbed my matching pair of 9mm with extended clips, just in case. I handed one of them to my wife. I said, "Don't let anything see it. Just put it behind your back." I turned on the floodlight, and there was nothing at all to see out there. I told her to give me that gun back, and she should go to the gun safe and grab the .30-06, whichever one she wanted, load it, and be at the kitchen window, just in case. Then I said I was going outside. I put both guns in their holsters on my side, and I put my sweater on top so they couldn't be seen. I grabbed my big industrial flashlight and went outside. I can't lie, I was shaking like a leaf. I go down the deck steps, and I turn to the right, which is facing the trees. I'm flashing the trees all over with my flashlight, and I have the floodlight on. I walk to the back of the house. I go around my garage, and still there's nothing. I turn back around to the left of me, and I go back to the trees. Nothing. I walk up to the tree stump again, and I hit it. Boom, boom, boom. I waited. Then I walk to the deck with my back to the tree still. Then I hear it. Boom. I stopped right before I got to the steps of my deck, and I looked over at the kitchen window. I see my wife standing there, and she's looking at me. Slowly and quietly, she motions over to the trees as if to start shooting. I about piss my pants. I motion for her to stay still and do nothing. I told her before I went out that if I start shooting, she should shoot, but she was not to shoot until I did. If it gets violent, it's going to come for me and not you, I had told her. She said, okay. I told her she was supposed to be just my cover. She said she understood. So I turn around slowly with my left hand on one of the guns and the flashlight in my right hand. I turn around slowly and I put the flashlight up. Now, if you guys are already disbelieving of my story, you sure are not going to believe this next part. It's a whole different part that you will not believe. So, there they were. And there were three of them. Three out of the four that I had seen many years ago. Yes, the same Bigfoot. When I was 16 and we pulled away in the truck from that tree line, there had been four of them there. I guess there was the grandpa, the grandma, the son, and another one. That was my guess. But now there was only three of them. It was the big one with the brown and white hair. Then there was another one with blackish brown hair. And then there was the mom. You could tell she was female because she had breasts. She also wasn't as cut and lean or straight and muscular as the others. Well, they're standing right where the other had been all that day. He was in the middle. Then there was a tree to the right of him. And on the other side of the tree was the other male. Then on the left of him was the female. They were all out in the open. They weren't hiding behind any tree. They were standing there in full view. The one with the white hair, the big one, well, he has my backpack in his hand. He lifted it up, and then he pointed at me. Then he pointed at the bag. Then he pointed at me again. I gave him a thumbs up. I think he understood then, because I did the thumbs up, and I pointed at him at the exact same time. I think he got it. Then they all started making sounds like monkeys do in the zoo, like when they're excited. About that time, my neighbor's dogs started barking. They're the two big Great Danes, and they're out almost all the time. And they notice everything, and they're always barking. So I was surprised that they weren't barking the first time that he dropped off the bag that day, because it was only about 10 feet from their fence. So they start barking, and it kind of spooks the group of Bigfoot out there. They step back a little bit fast, and I put up my hands, and I tell them, slow down. Then I told them to stop, and they did. They stopped for a minute. I put the flashlight down because the floodlight was now enough light. I show my hands while I'm walking to the fence line. That made them back up a little bit, but slowly. The one on the right might have been the son when I was 16. He steps up behind a tree, kind of guarding himself. So half of him is showing and half of him is not. The others are standing away from him. Then the mom steps back, and she keeps stepping back a little bit. Then she turns and walks. I have my hands up. I get to the fence line, and I give another thumbs up. I point at the backpack, and he looks down at the bag in his hands. I put my hand on my mouth and act like I'm spooning food in with my left hand, and then I point back at the backpack. He looks down, then he looks back up. I'm still doing the spooning motion with my hand at my mouth with my left hand, and I give him another thumbs up with my right. And as God is my witness, he gives me a thumbs up back. Behind me, I heard my wife say, "Oh my God." I held up my hand to my wife, palm down. Then I turned it back up. I turned around and walked inside the house. And right before I get to the door, I turned around. The Bigfoot on the right is now gone, but the big one is still there, but he's backing up slowly. I give him another thumbs up, and I go in. Me and my wife hug each other. She said, "They're communicating with you." I said, "I know." I got chills when I said that. We talked about it all night. We sat up, we made French toast, and we talked all night until around 6 a.m. And we kept looking out the windows all night. But they didn't come back. I told my wife that I had put a jar of moonshine in that backpack. She asked me, why would I do that? I said I just wanted to see them drink, and I wanted a picture in my head of them opening it and drinking it. I was sure they were going to let me see them drink it. I said it's not going to hurt them, and I had given them a smorgasbord of food. Here in Colorado, the special happy plant, if you get my meaning, well, the one you can smoke is legal. So I should have given them some edibles, I thought, but I hadn't thought of it in time. Maybe next time. But I haven't seen him since that day, and I'm always looking outside. And the dogs will go on out in the yard now, too. I'm still wondering how he found me. I didn't live there when I was 16 years old. This is my wife's house. She got it from her grandma and grandpa. I lived on the other side of town, which is not very far, but all in all, it still baffles my mind. I don't know how they found where I lived. My scent shouldn't have been there for many years, and it was my wife's grandparents' house that we were now living in. I grew up in Walsenburg, Colorado, which is 16 miles north of Aguilar. So for them to find me where I live now, that's really messing with my head. My wife talks about it every day. Maybe somebody can let me know, maybe one of the listeners. My mind is just too boggled. On February 26, 2023, I saw my uncle in Walsenburg, Colorado. In my car, I had the bag that he had had all those years ago. I lifted it up, and I gave it to him. He looked at it. Then he looked at me like, "Are you kidding me?" I said, "No." Then I told him the story that I had just told you about the bullet and my grandpa's knife. Then I showed him the knife. He looked at it, and he said, "Yeah. They must have been trying to do something with it." They opened it, and it was a little bit beat up and a bit loose, like the screws were loose, but it was still being held together. I told him the whole story that I've just told you. He said I was joking with him. I said no, and he could ask my wife about it. I said, "This whole story's true, word for word, every little bit of it, and no one's going to believe us." I said, "You don't even believe me. And you were with me when we saw them when I was 16 years old. And I have just given you proof. That's your backpack that you had. He said he just got chills all over. I said, I've had chills since the 20th when it all happened. He asked me if I'd seen them since. I said no. Then he asked if I thought they would come back. I said maybe. Hopefully. Then he said he wasn't coming to my house ever again. I said, they're not dangerous. I just told you the whole story. I fed him, and hopefully he'll bring my bag back and we can try it again. We can get some cameras and put them up, I said. Then I mentioned I had some trail cameras. He said, no, get some video surveillance cameras that can record 24/7. Point them up there and get zoomed in with good clarity. Get good picture. Set them up every night and keep that light on. And make sure the cameras have night vision on them with motion sensors for the lights. Let's try to videotape them. I said, so you're in. You're going to help me do this. He said, nope, I'm not going to your house ever again. I asked him if he was going to pitch in and help me buy all these cameras. Again, he said, nope, I'm never going to your house again. I was like, thanks, Uncle. Then he said he was too old for all of this. And I answered him with, like I'm not? I mean, trust me, I stay in shape. I don't do drugs, I work out, and I eat healthy. And if they wanted to, though, those Bigfoot could destroy me. But they don't want to do that. The look on that big one's face, the white-haired one, we connected when we looked at each other for those 5 minutes straight. It was the longest 5 minutes I've ever had. But we connected, and he knows I'm his friend. I could feel it, and I knew he knew what thumbs up meant. I told my uncle that I was going to buy the cameras. I was going to get them ready. I'll set everything up, and we'll see if we can catch them on camera, and then I'll send it to all of you guys there. Also, now I'm telling you all that I have 4 other paper stories that were before this and after my first encounter at 16, but this one ties into my first one, so that's why I told you this one. I'll keep sending in more stories, and for anyone that doesn't believe me, I don't care. I know what I saw. I know what happened. Look, I don't know how he found me, but he did. So if anyone out there has any ideas of how he found me, I sure would like to know. I hope that you've all enjoyed this story. I'll send in my other 4 stories soon. I just hope you believe me because I know this story sounds unbelievable. Also, I mentioned noting where his head was against the tree so that I could measure it later. I did. He was over 9 feet tall. Almost 9.5 feet. I'm going to say he weighed over 700 pounds. His legs were like tree trunks, and his arms were longer than I am tall, and I'm 5 feet 10 inches tall. His muscle tone was amazing. You know the world's strongest men that you see on TV? Well, they don't compare to him. Those guys look like me compared to him. I'm 5'10 and 180 pounds. But this guy, this Bigfoot, he's like a walking school bus. I know he knows I'm his friend now, and I hope he comes again. I'll keep surveillance, and I'll try to catch him on video, and I'll try to send it to you. Also, if anyone would like to call me and talk to me about this or hear it straight from me, my phone number is... And I'm not going to release that, folks. Hang on. Anyway, he goes on to say, my name is Chris. I hope you enjoy this story. Everyone, stay safe out there. God bless you all, and I hope you guys enjoy it. Take care. All right, my Sasquad. Well, I do have a few things I'm going to touch on about Chris's email. First of all, that phone number. He really did put his phone number in the email. And the way I read it, he did want me to give it out to everyone, but I am positively not giving out a phone number for the entire internet. While I would say 99.9% of everyone that listens to this channel is normal, there's a whole lot of crazy out there. I wouldn't do that to anyone. But if you do want to speak to Chris, email me. I will privately send you his phone number unless Chris instructs me to handle this otherwise. I just included it because, well, like I said, that's how he wrote it. I think he does want to talk to somebody about these experiences. And, you know, I think that's always a good thing. I think that's pretty constructive and a little cathartic for some people. And also, Chris was mentioning a story he had written to us before, and I will put that link to that video in the video description before. If you want to go back and listen to the encounter that started way back when he was 16 years old, and it's pretty riveting. It's him and his uncle out there hunting, and they literally kind of have to shoot their way out just to get back to their truck and get out of there. So it's pretty amazing that he thinks this is the same group of Bigfoot that have somehow found him now. It's kind of scary. Okay, a little bit of housekeeping. I know I mentioned a live stream recently that I was going to do some question and answers. I'm going to set that up for this Sunday, March 26, 6 p.m. Eastern Time. I'll put something up in the community area probably Wednesday or Thursday, so you all will have a link to click on. I also have a long list of questions that people have sent in the last few months. That's what I'll be mostly answering for you. Some of these are funny. Some of these are awesome, some of these questions. But if you have a question and you haven't sent it in, you can send it in at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. Just put question in the item, what you call it, the RE. Can't think of it, subject. Put it in the subject line. Or you can just save it for that evening and ask me in the live stream in that evening. Also, speaking of sending things in, I am still working on this whole new format of how I'm setting things up. And I'm not asking for people to send in encounters. I'm not doing that. I do put this up on the screen. But if you do have an encounter, please send that in. We always need them. You can send it to contact@buckeyebigfoot.com. All right, everyone. Well, whew, that's a lot for me tonight. I think it's all for now. And until we meet up again later this week, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone.